Dramatic Records, John Petrucci.
Hello. How you doing? Cool. Too dark up here? In here? I like the dark. I like the mood. Yeah. Is anybody coming to see Dream Theater at Universal today?
Yeah.
Yeah? Cool. Yeah, that's today. You guys know who Steve Morse is, right? Yeah, he's playing in Deep Purple, and I get to see him every night, which is unbelievable. The guy is just amazing. Okay, it works. So is it like all guitar players here, or mostly? Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to talk about a lot of guitar things, obviously. And, you know, anything that you have questions about, like, feel free to ask. But I'm going to do some, teach some of the stuff that I'm going through. So get something educational. This is a school, right? Gotta do something educational. But what I'm gonna do is I have a CD, and on the CD is a bunch of, it's like guitar karaoke, I guess. It's music without the guitar. And a lot of it is from this side project that I did recently. It's called Liquid Tension Experiment. And I recorded a record with Mike Portnoy, our drummer, and Tony Levin, and Jordan Rudis. And I thought it'd be cool to play for you guys, so I'm going to start playing one of the songs. It's the first song on that album. It's called Paradigm Shift. We'll be right back. Thank you. It's kind of loud, isn't it? Sound all right? Okay, cool. That's called Paradigm Shift, and that whole album was kind of weird. We got together and less than a week we wrote these songs and recorded them, and so it was very experimental. Thus, Liquid Tension Experiment. Anyway, we're planning on doing another one of those real soon, so that should be fun. I can't really see too much if anybody has any questions, but...
Is that CD available?
Is that CD available? Well, not this one without the guitar mixed on it, but yeah. Yeah, it is available. Most of the stuff was done on the spot, but like I had that riff, like it was kind of just—I was just kind of joking around with it, actually, and it turned out to be something. You know, that whole sort of technique—it's kind of like Van Halen-ish, like he does. That's where I got that from. He does something like that. Like. I think he does some sort of riff like. Right? So I was kind of playing off of that sort of thing. You know, you have just kind of pulling off an open string. And then playing another note below it on another string. This happens to be the same note. What kind of thing? It's fun. So that's the technique that I primarily use in that song. There was something else in there that I wanted to point out. It's a lot of the faster kind of stuff in that song is happening. It's mostly in G. And let's see. Like the scale that I'm using is basically just pentatonic for a lot of those riffs. But sometimes I throw the flat five in there, and also the sixth. So that's kind of the vibe of a lot of the fast parts. Like when I'm the intro. That kind of vibe. And there's some part in the middle that's just so you can see like how sort of an exercise turned into a riff. That's something I do to practice picking. It's like sort of patterns on 1 to 2 strings, like things like that. They're real, real typical sort of things, right? Like that. And then when you add like another note on another string, that's a lot of those type of exercises that I practice to kind of get some speed and accuracy with my right and left hand. So you look. So that riff there centralizes around that kind of pattern. And that's where a lot of the ideas for the song came from. So I guess it's kind of an example where you could take like things that are exercise oriented and turn it into some sort of cool song. I'm on tour right now, so that's a good example. Like, I don't know, maybe an hour or so before, sometimes less. It depends on the day. Days off, maybe a couple hours. And then the other time is just spent more writing and stuff. But I think there's a certain amount of like maintenance that needs to be done to keep your chops together. Okay. Yeah. I mean, there's a certain amount to the certain part of playing live where you're, I guess you're in practice, but it's more like that's the show, that's the performance. So everything that you practice kind of comes to play there. But there's certainly an element of, you know, just kind of trying new things and experimenting, and I suppose that's kind of practice as well. But as far as like playing the guitar, there's such a thing as overplaying. So especially when you play a show and you kind of play hard and you're traveling, I mean, you don't really have to play 10 hours a day. It's probably not such a good thing. So I don't play too much so I don't kill myself. But you know, a couple hours here and there. Well, I went to Berkeley for a year, but before then, those are the years where you kind of need to take advantage of the time that you have to practice. But yeah, I would sit there for 3 to 6 hours more a day and, you know, just kind of work on stuff because, you know, I didn't have a job or I didn't have to do anything really. And like I said, those are real formative years. It's a good time to take advantage of that. You know, unless you're doing it professionally, it's hard to, I know it's hard for a lot of people to find the time. So yeah, I used to really sit there and go for it for long periods of time. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Berkeley is it's a jazz school, you know, so stuff I was working on were like a lot of basic theory, but it was all from a jazz perspective, you know, jazz harmony and composition and stuff like that. And I did like chord melody and, you know, I only went for a year, so I kind of got through the first two semesters of initial training. I didn't get into the real, you know, application on guitar, taking it further. If I would have stayed there, I'm sure I would have done that. But I had a mission. Had to leave. Had a band to make. Yeah, Dream Theater formed there, and then we decided to leave. Yeah, decided to rock the world. he's asking if I have any sort of signature licks or sounds or whatever. What's that? Yeah, chromatic is a big part of my playing. And I get that from listening to a lot of Dregs and Steve Morris. He puts that into his playing a lot. Also, I think sort of intervallic type playing is a part of my sound. And certainly, actually from a drummer's perspective, rhythmic, the rhythms that are in a song, they're very tight with the drums. Like all that I have in my monitors live are drums, and all that Mike has is guitar, so we're real locked in. Yeah. And besides that, I think kind of the chordal work. Like I listened to Rush a lot when I grew up, so I like a lot of sounds that have a nice kind of chordal. No, never met those guys. Yeah. But cool, you guys have lots of questions. Usually it's like, any questions? Crickets. But, yeah. What's up? I never studied classical, no. No. I'd like to, though. That would be very cool. I'm going to play some more music. This next song I'm going to play is actually it's a cover tune. And see if you can guess what song it is. Thank you. Name that tune. That's right. What's that? that song, I remember when it came out, it really hit me. I loved that chord progression. I thought it was so cool. And, you know, it's things like that that you kind of latch onto when you're first playing. And, you know, it's a real good thing to practice. I used to sit there all day and just like I just did to annoy you all. And I used to play like that, you know, over that progression, because the song just really is the same thing over and over. And it was fun to do. I used to do that with Iron Maiden records, too, and Dio records. No, not Kiss, no. No, but the cool thing about Iron Maiden, Dio, and stuff like that, it was always in, like, the songs were always in E or A or F sharp. And so you can just jam all day long on that stuff. So that was kind of fun. Anyway, that was Purple Rain. Any questions about that? Yeah. How many sounds do I use per song? Well, I'll give you kind of a rundown. This rig that I have right now, let me just explain what it is. It's quite experimental. Because on the road, I have these racks that are really big. They're too big because I use a lot of different heads and a lot of different effects to try to achieve what I do on the record. So there's like a 22 space rack and a 20 space rack, and it's like two refrigerators. very professionally wired up by Mark Snyder, who's a good friend of mine that does that stuff. But nonetheless, it's a lot. So obviously, I'm not going to bring that stuff into this situation. And there's also a part of me that wants to kind of downsize. So I'm experimenting with what's behind me. So what it is there's a Mesa Boogie Tri-Axis, which is a MIDI programmable preamp that kind of it emulates the sounds of all the different classic boogie heads, like Mark IVs, Mark Is, Mark IIcs, and stuff like that. And then the power amp is a 290 power amp. That's a boogie power amp. And all the sounds are coming from there. And as far as the effects, there's two different things. There's an MPX-1 G2 by Lexicon that's not out yet that I'm kind of experimenting with. And all the different things like the volume pedal and the wah-wah and noise gates and stuff like that are coming from that unit, as well as some delays and chorusing that I'll show you. And the other one is an Eventide GTR 4000, which is a harmonizer, where all the delays and modulation effects are coming from. So I'll just kind of run through basically what I need to get through shows. I guess it kind of starts with a clean sound, which, yeah, to me, it has to be really, really clean. So I usually have like chorusing on. Who asked the question about the sounds? Where is he? Usually like chorusing on it and some delays you can hear. It's like stereo delays and chorus. To do that type of stuff. So that's the clean that I go for. It's like that. And this guitar, let me just talk about this, because this is influencing the sound too. This is my signature model. It's an Ibanez guitar. We call it a JPM 100. And basically, we came out with different colors of this graphic, but the guitars are pretty much the same. And one of the features of this that's real cool for getting clean sounds is you can see there's no center pickup, because that usually gets in the way of my picking, so I don't have one. So there's just two humbuckers. And the reason why there's no mounting, what are they called? Mounting rings or whatever? Is because I like to put my pinky, I like to kind of anchor it. Can you guys see on there? The screen? I like to anchor it right below the pickup there. And that gives me a good reference point. And then also the volume control is pushed way down. So because my pinky's there, I would normally like hit into it and knock the volume down, so we have it moved way down. But anyway, about the clean, when you're in the middle position, it takes these two center pickups and makes them hum canceling, and it kind of like has an effect where it scoops out the mid range, and you can hear the difference. Like, this is just the bridge, and this is just the neck. When you put it in the middle, there's really a major difference in the sound. So I like to use it for that type of chordal working. And that kind of explains the clean. And then basically I go for like a sound that's real dry for a lot of the rhythm stuff. And it doesn't have a lot of gain to it. It's more dry, and it's better for like real tight rhythm stuff. Like that. But that sound kind of could change if I wanted to. I can add like a spread to it. Or like some delays to that. So then you kind of go from having a real dry sound to like a real, like I said before, rush, kind of Alex Lifeson. That's another sound that I typically use. It's real stereo sounding. And then as far as the lead tones, basically, this amp is emulating a Mark IV lead tone, which is one of my favorite boogie amps. And I have different types of delays on them, usually stereo delays. This one's a little bit more mellow. I was using that in Paradigm Shift for the Soul. So, kind of gives you a lot of stuff to play with, and some of the delays are more simple. It's like a chorusing delay. I think that sounds better on the faster stuff. And then some of the delays also change the tone of the guitar as they delay, like. So this is kind of a real versatile sound. Could change it as I'm playing, like. So those are the main sounds that I use. So they're really they're not very bizarre. They're very much based in like modulating effects, like choruses and delays, you know, to create a stereo vibe. And that's basically how I go for sound. So it starts with the sound of the amp, basically clean, then something real tight and dry, and then something more smooth and wet for leads, and then delays and chorus effects like that. And I like to have the versatility to change those sounds as I'm playing. That's the fun thing. It's kind of like, having more controls. It's like driving a stick shift instead of an automatic. Yeah. Yeah, the sounds are being changed by the pedal board through MIDI, yeah. He's asking, like, what did I hear that made me want to play guitar? I think it started really early. Like, I used to have dreams about playing guitar that were kind of bizarre. I'd have these recurring dreams that I was playing acoustic or something. And that was one thing. Also, my sister, who's older than me, played, she was taking organ lessons, and she got to stay up later than me, so I figured I'd show her and I'd take an instrument. That was another reason. And the other reason is there was a lot of people in my neighborhood. I was real fortunate that were just musicians, you know, walking around the street playing Stairway to Heaven, playing acoustics, jamming at people's houses, and I really wanted to be a part of it. And I think like most people that you run into, probably all you guys who are musicians, you have a big artistic side to you. And a lot of people I meet that are musicians also at one point, maybe they still do, were artists or writers or whatever. And that was me when I was little. I loved writing and painting and drawing, and it's just kind of part of my nature. I think that's typical artistic type. Most musicians are like that. My first band, well, we were a cover band. I mean, we were young. We were kids, you know, playing the Rolling Stones and stuff. Yeah. The solos that I record with Dream Theater, are they improvised? Is that the question? Right. Well, the solos that I record on any record, I mean, it depends on the song. You know, some rhythm sections are real... They really lend themselves to what you just said. Hit the record button. Let's see what's happening. They're very kind of, maybe the chord progression isn't too complicated and it's real loose and you can go for it. And then other times there's some changes or rhythmical things that are happening that you really got to lock into. And I'll work that out more. So it really is a combination of improvising and working some stuff out. When we play live, I usually I stick pretty close to the solos that are on the record. Because they're very melody based, and then I'll go off a little bit, but I stick pretty close to the solos. And we usually to get out of that humdrum kind of stage, we usually have improv sections during the show, so I can, you know, get it out of my system at that point. Yeah, he's talking about playing, you know, playing. I guess you're talking about stamina. You're playing a lot of fast passages or whatever. Do I ever get tired? And the answer is yes. I mean, especially if a live show is lasting over 2 hours or whatever. I think that's where the maintenance kind of comes in. You know, it's very much like an athlete. Like, you can't just not train and go play a game. You're going to be winded, you know. So that's why you have to work on this over and over. It seems like even though you could play stuff, why do you keep practicing it? And usually the reason for me is to build stamina, to be able to keep going. What's that? How do you practice that? You use a metronome. You don't have to necessarily play really fast. You just, like, play steady. You know, play to a metronome that's a real, real steady source. And, you know, concentrate on... You also play a lot of different things that concentrate on the same technique to be really well-rounded. You know, instead of just playing the same thing, the same one thing, try to vary your practicing. But I would say the best way to build stamina is working with a consistent rhythm source. You know, this way you can kind of control, and if you gradually build that up, you know, that's how you build your stamina too. Okay, all right. I'm gonna play another song. This one's also from that Liquid Tension Experiment record. It's called Universal Mind. All right, let's see what happens. Try using that. We'll be right back. Thanks. Haven't played some of these songs in a long time. They're kind of hard to remember. I'm going along saying to myself, I wonder if I remember the next part. And sometimes I don't. As you can tell. But anyway, that was called Universal Mind. That's also from that record. And that's a fun one to play. Any questions? Any other questions? String skipping. Yeah, that song has a lot of that stuff in it. I mean, the trick to doing that is to stop the other ones from ringing out that you're skipping over, right? that's the hard part. I mean, a good way to practice that is you can take any sort of thing, let's say that's between two strings that are next to each other, and just start eventually gradually separating, playing where there's one string in the middle, then two strings in the middle, but you can keep the same pattern going. I think that's a good way to practice that. I'll show you what I mean. Then you go to a rhythm sound, and it's dry. So it's a cool feature of that eventide. So anyway, what was I talking about? Oh, yeah. So you can take like something like, let's say you want to practice string skipping. Take something that's between two strings, like this. There's two notes on a string. And then try just taking that same pattern, but, you know, skipping the string in the middle. And do it in whatever key you're in. This happens to be, G, so. And you can practice that, right? But the key is you gotta avoid that string in the middle. You know, another similar one you can do is here's an easy one. I was doing that before with when I was showing you Paradigm Shift. Just take that bottom note and put it on the G string. Another cool one is you can take this sort of pattern that's and trade the top note for a note on a higher string. That's a good exercise for string skipping as well. That's a good one for that. What I was doing in the last song was, so here's a pattern, and you just skip the middle string. Okay. All right. So how's that for string skipping? All right, just keep the middle one quiet. That's the key. Well, I guess this question is about like playing things like arpeggios with like a sweep type thing. I think the key is that the key is to that that you have the key to that is you have to separate the notes. You know, that's the most important thing. Otherwise, they all squish into one another. So like, there's two different methods. One is just with the right hand. You have to sort of. You have to kind of drag the pick. Like you can't try to play each note individually and come off. Like, you know, in classical, I guess that's a rest stroke when you rest onto the next string. You have to, like, press the pick against each string. So it's like, as opposed to, so you have all consecutive down or all consecutive up. So without even playing anything, it almost sounds like some sort of sweep technique. So that's the first thing. Second thing is you have to, when you play something with the left hand, you have to mute the other strings so they don't all ring out. Like if you played them all together, like, would sound like that. But if you separate the notes, then then you get the arpeggio. So the way you do it is you just kind of roll your fingers, like you play one note with the tip of your finger, one note with the middle part, one note with the and you kind of mute each string adjacent to the one that you're playing. So it's a technique of muting with the left hand and separating with the right hand. So no matter what you're actually practicing, whatever arpeggio thing it is, you have to get the technique first, right? So I find it's all in the separating the notes. Okay? The next song that I'm going to play is very different from everything that I've been playing. It's more based on melody, actually. And just real briefly, this is a type of thing, to me, that I think separates really great players and makes them stand out. It's not necessarily... Hi. Photo session will be later. It's not necessarily the technique, because I'm sure you know a lot of guys that really have great technique, but to me, it's how they make the guitar as an instrument speak individually to that, you know, with their own voice. And I think in the use of melody and phrasing techniques and the way that you manipulate the sounds of the electric guitar, bending and vibrato and sliding and all those subtleties, to me, is what separates players and what makes players stand out is, being lyrical or mature or whatever you wanted to call it. So this next song is all based in melody, and I'll demonstrate some of what I'm talking about. It's called State of Grace.
Thank you.
Thanks. So, you see, that was a lot different than all the stuff I've been playing, which stuff I've been playing has been, you know, more kind of bombastic and crazy. And that was just a song based around the melody of the guitar, where there's just piano accompaniment and the guitar is the voice. And I think Joe Satriani is probably the most famous for that type of playing in a you know, modern day sense, so far as lyrical rock guitar. And also, when you play like that, to me, a lot of the effects have to do with how that comes off, because when you manipulate the tone of the guitar with your hands, and then there are some effects that are kind of trailing off or whatnot, it adds to it. Like, I mean, that whole last thing that I played, if I was just to have a dry sound, I mean, it could sound pretty. But it sounds better if it's like this. You can see how that can have an influence on how you sound, as opposed to having a cheesy, clicky, dry sound. Nothing worse than that, right? Anyway, any questions about that? Any of the techniques that were used in that? Yeah. How I approach my songwriting. Well, I mean, if I'm writing with a band or with other people, then that type of songwriting is really based on an interaction between musicians. You know, whether it's like jamming, there's like a drum groove that kind of inspires you to come up with something, or chord progression, or whatever. That's real interactive songwriting, and that kind of comes right, you know, right off the cuff, right off the top of what you have. It's real interactive. And then there's another type where if I'm just by myself and I'm kind of coming up with something, and when I write like that, I tend to write the melody and the chord progression together, and sometimes even the lyric. And that's more of a personal kind of private side of writing, where it's coming more from an inspiration that's not based on playing with somebody else, but that's coming from another source. You know, whatever the topic may be, whatever the subject may be. And that's basically where I'm coming from, when it comes to writing. And then, of course, I use whatever knowledge and influences I've gained through the years, you know, starts to come out in the type of music that I write. Most of Dream Theater's writing is collaborative. We get together and we like to jam on things and record it and see what happens with stuff. Who's the genius? The producer is the genius. Yeah, what's up? Wait, is that Bill?
Yeah.
What are you doing here? I'm sorry. What are you doing here?
I live here now.
Do you? Cool. I went to school with him. Bill Totolo, everybody. That's so weird. I'm looking out. I'm like, wait a second. You look familiar. Where do you live? Cool. Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's hard to go by memory, you know, because a lot of times things, like, they happen just on the spot, and, you know, it's hard to remember. So I record them or write them down. And if I don't have any means of doing that, I have to consciously try to remember it, like, you know, just kind of embed it in my memory. Because, I mean, you know, some things that are really good, they come and go. How do I use scales and chords? Well, I mean, they're real related to one another. I'm not sure how to answer that. I think that the type of chord progression, the type of chords that are being used, and the motion of the progression, will dictate the scales that are being used. Do you go to school here, or yeah? I'm sure they'll teach you about. Do you know about that already, or relationship from chords to scales? I guess it's pretty involved. You know. I think it's actually a good question. It's an important question because you can one of the things I used to do, sometimes I still do it, is you can have like a one chord song, one chord progression, and you could change the sound and the whole mood just by changing the type of scale. And the different scales will have different tensions that correspond or conflict with that chord. You know, and that will kind of change the mood. I mean, just to give you a quick, I don't know if I can do this by myself. I don't have a, well, I do have a sampler, but I don't know how to use it. No. Let's see, maybe I can use that delay thing. If you have a, that's just basically one note, right? You can make the tonality like, it's very major sounding, but I could make that sound change very easily and change the whole mood, right? So that's a Mixolydian mode I'm playing, but the whole, you know, the mood of it changes regardless of what the hell it's called. You know, it's how it, what it sounds like, how it makes you feel. I mean, here's even another one, right? So that, I guess, in answer to your question, it's really the relationship between them that creates the type of mood to the piece, you know? So does that make sense? What, the mirror? Well, I think it's just really wah-wah. Yeah. If you're talking about, well, that's played on a seven string, but, you know, primarily. Is that what you mean? Whoa, sorry. There's like some delay, probably, yeah. But, you know, you can use a wah pedal to really kind of make a lot of times I'll use it and people ask, you know, what effect is that? It's just a wah. You know, if you use it to shape the notes, instead of using it rhythmically, like traditionally, you can kind of just slowly shape the tone of the notes and it gives a pretty cool effect. Sometimes it sounds like a phaser. Sometimes it sounds like a flanger or something weird. But it's just the wah-wah, very slow movement of the wah to shape the notes. Yeah. How did I get my endorsement with Ibanez? well, that's actually a good question. No, well, when we when I did our first album, it's called When Dream and Day Unite. It was on a little label, and we recorded it in Pennsylvania, and it was very close to where the Ibanez factory is. They're in Bent Salem, Pennsylvania. And the engineer knew the artist guy, and he's like, hey, you want me to hook you up? You know, and that's how most things happen, right? So he hooked me up. I talked to the guy, and relationship started from there, very slowly built. And it's wonderful. You know, this is, we have, including the anniversary model of this guitar, we have five different models, and now we're also doing a signature acoustic as well. And they've been great. They're a great company to deal with. Very cool guys. Yeah. The guitar is my design, not the graphic, though. This graphic's done by an artist named Dan Lawrence. He's a freelance artist for that did some work for Ibanez. But as far as the wood, positions of the effects, the type of toggle this is, and fret size and all that, that's, you know, basically I developed it over a course of years. This is what we came up with.
Yeah.
I mean, just now when I was doing that?
Yeah, the really spacey, fresh
sound. Let's see.
That's the Eventide harmonizer. And, all right. It's basically,
you can do a lot of cool things with that harmonizer. It's basically delays. It's delays, and they're kind of all modulating into one another. There's no one pedal you can get to do. I mean, put it this way: if you had like a pedal that just did delay, just a single delay, it kind of wouldn't cut it. You know, I mean, if you set it so that it had a lot of feedback and a lot of repeats, and you faded in the volume of the notes, you can kind of get that effect. Because that's really what it is. But in this case, you can hear if I play one click, like, see what's happening? The tone is changing. It's repeating into one another. So, all right, I'll give you an example. If you guys will be patient, let's see. All right, here's a simple version. Okay, here's a sound. Let's say this is your guitar, right? Just totally dry in an amp, right? And you have a delay pedal. So that's your one pedal you can get, is a delay pedal, right? Now this. Okay, so you have a delay pedal going. Here, I'll tell you what. Wait, hold, give me a second. All right, this is it. This is as far as I go. All right, I just put something in there that will kind of imitate your one delay pedal with a delay on it. And you just set it so that it the feedback is way up. So you get something like this. Right? That's about the extent of how delay pedals sound these days, right? See how it's echoing? And then you just play a note and fade the volume in. Not as good, but that's kind of the vibe. You're welcome. I like to customize my appearances for everybody's needs. Okay, I'm going to, I have to go to soundcheck real soon, so I'm going to just play a couple of short songs that are fun, and that's basically going to be it. But I did recently, I wrote some music for a Sega video game. Yeah, that was kind of fun. The game's called Necronomicon, and it was actually for a Japanese company, so I don't think it's available here. But it's called Necronomicon. It's a digital pinball game, and I wrote this music for it. It's just very, very short. One song's like a minute and a half. The other song's like 2.5 minutes. They asked me to write this music, and I did, so I'll play it for you. It's kind of fun. It's goofy. You got to picture yourself playing pinball when you listen to it. So I'll play that. But thank you very much for coming, and I want to thank Ibanez for setting this up and all the people here at MI. And I hope that you guys, if you don't have tickets, get some tickets, come down and see the show. If not to see us, you got to see Deep Purple and Steve. But thanks. So let's check this out. Thank you.